all these speakers are up on stage. I'm sure you've been thinking lots of questions, so I'm seeing lots of very interesting tweets out there. So why don't I, you can maybe raise your hand once you've got a question, and then I'll point it to them and anybody can answer.
It's about the dairy system. I was under the impression that, as opposed to the U.S. dairy system, the Canadian dairy system, the quota system and everything, more supports small local family farms. Is that not true?
Yeah. Thanks. I'm actually glad to have this question because there's a lot of confusion around that. Canada has a supply-managed system of dairy and poultry and eggs and a few commodities. And that means that they manage the supply so there's never too much milk in the system so that the price to the farmer goes down, or there's never not enough milk in the system so the consumer doesn't have milk. So they manage the supply, but in the world trade system, that's viewed as being protectionist. So we're not allowed to export anything into other markets. So Canada's not a dairy exporting country because we don't import. Because our system is closed, that means we produce just the right amount of milk and dairy products that our country needs. So that's all managed by a federal body and every provincial body. Every province has their own body that it works on population. So if you wanted to start dairy farming, for instance, you would have to approach the milk marketing board to see if you could get into that system. In other words, is there enough, is there need for more milk? And can I start producing milk to sell? So it means that there can't be 100 new farmers producing too much milk, which would just get wasted or can't get sold for a good price. But that means the quota at this point in time has to be purchased. In other words, just the license to sell milk has to be purchased. And that price fluctuates on the market depending on the demand, etc. Every province, the price is a little bit different. In Western BC, there's a lot of demand for milk because it's a very good dairy producing area because the climate is good. There's a lot of grass grown, etc. It's easy to, in the prairies, it's hard to have dairy cows because the winters are so harsh, etc. So that system is the Canadian system. In America, there is, in the US, there is no supply managed system. As an individual farmer, you have to find a contract with a processor. So if I want to farm, I'd have to go find a processor to take my milk and make a contract with them so that they would continue to take my milk, because you've got your mortgage, you've got your house. Dairy is a very expensive farming occupation. Animals are individual people, and they need high care. They're all lactating mothers, really, so they need the best diet, the best environment to be functioning, and all the equipment is very expensive. And so sometimes you'll go across the border to the States and you'll see a farm that was functioning 6 months ago, lots of cows around, and now it's dead. They don't have that guarantee that in Canada keeps you with a fair price for your milk. So I hope that answers your question. In Canada, the farmers get a fair price for their milk, and they guarantee that they'll have a sale for the milk. In the US, they don't have that. They have a contract, but you know how contracts are. If the processor goes out of business, they can't honor that contract. So there's that insecurity there.
Right. So with the quota system, it's harder for new farmers to get into farming in Canada, right?
That's right, because there's a limited amount of milk that needs to be produced.
Right.
And so until an older farmer goes out of business or changes or whatever, that quota will come free. Or if there's an increase in market, for instance, the Canadian Dairy Commission offers quota for processors like me. We're just a little on-farm cheese, but we're an official processor. If we can create products that show innovation so that it will create more market for Canadian milk and cheese. So I went to Ottawa and presented some of our cheeses to the Canadian Dairy Commission, and they granted us production quota, which is only produced on our farm because it's made of grass-fed milk from Guernsey and Brown Swiss cows, and those cheeses that we make out of those specifically are Alpine Gold, Country Blue, Castle Blue, and our Gruyere, which are called Heidi, and our Fermier, which is a promising style. They're all unique to our farm, so we were given production quota. So that's how you can get more quota, if you can increase the market.
That's what I was gonna ask. What happens if you choose, you create a different product from that that be?
That quota has been granted to me only if I do not take away market from another similar cheese. So what I did when I went, I took also artisan cheeses from my fellow BC artisan cheesemakers so that the commission could taste them and see the difference, that I wasn't going to be taking market from Lynn Qualicum or from a Moonstruck or whatever, because the cheeses weren't the same. So yeah, so that's how. So there is always quota available, and the milk marketing system does have a program for young farmers, and you can sign up for that, and then that quota will be given to you to use for a certain number of years, and then you start paying it back. But there is an initiative or an innovative program for young farmers to get started. It just takes a long time.
So I've got one question here for John, actually. How is it that you can't really get your wine in Halifax and Ontario and that kind of thing, yet you're exporting to China? So maybe you can explain how that sort of works and how you, maybe in a little nutshell, how you actually got into China and now the UK, and I'm sure you're going to other world markets. I know your story about in China, he was actually telling me a story about a little while ago how expensive his wine is in China. Yet, I mean, it's much more expensive there than it is here.
Just as a happenstance, because Painted Rock as a business model falls into a very interesting category where we're small enough that what we need are, we need direct-to-consumer business. We don't, I don't need the distribution channels of the LCBO in Ontario. I don't need the BC Liquor distribution. What I want to do is I want to find that thin layer of demographic throughout Canada. And so what Richard's alluding to in the first reference is the interprovincial shipping laws. Painted Rock has found itself squarely. I've become the poster kid for this, and I didn't intend to be, but I'm very passionate about my ability to be able to sell to Canadians. It's more easy for me to get my wine into Shanghai than it is to get it into Toronto, if you can believe it. So the provinces, there's just been a bill called Bill C-311 go through federally that will allow the interprovincial sale and transfer of wines, which is absolutely common sense, and there was a grassroots movement supported by all Canadians, and everybody rejoiced it passed. Well, the provinces swiftly threw up some new policy that said, okay, Ontarians, actually this policy was already in place, but residents of Ontario are allowed to physically bring in one case of wine across the border. And so our beautiful, fantastic British Columbia government decided to mirror that policy. So now we as British Columbians are allowed to physically bring across the border one case of wine. So if you feel like driving to Niagara, buying a case of wine, putting it in your van and driving back to BC, you can do it, but there's no room for any e-commerce. So I've really put feet to the fire of our British Columbia politicians to show some leadership right now. Ostensibly, the choice is right now, it's kind of like the bigger man theory. One province can't tell another province what to do, but they can show leadership. They can say, we're going to allow Ontario wines to come into British Columbia via e-commerce, and then and shame them into mirroring it. Shame them into doing for British Columbia wineries what we're doing for Ontario wineries. So that's kind of a little bit of Bill C-311 episode that I'm involved with right now. Our wines are getting, for me, our goal, because it's a generational family business that I want to create, is I want to grow the breadth of Painted Rock's brand outside of the borders of British Columbia and Canada. And so I spent one month in the last six in mainland China, and I've been in Shanghai and Chengdu and Beijing, building brand, and it's been on my nickel. I've got a partner there who buys, it's a very ironclad contract. They buy 20% of our production annually. It makes us viable. They buy it from the farm gate. They sourced us out because they recognize our mandate, and the fact that we weren't gonna get bigger, we were gonna get better, was what I'd always told them. So we've got a 60-acre bench. I don't want to, that produces 5,000 cases, that model I referred to before, and they wanted in, and which was very flattering. They said, okay, we'll buy 20% of your production. We'll buy it from the farm gate. So they take it from my winery. It's theirs. They distribute it in China. More power to them. I was there, and 3,399 renminbi equals $530 a bottle. That's what they're selling at Forum Shank.
Oh my God.
And yay, I mean, that's my icon. We sell it here for 55. So next time you go into China, put a couple in your suitcase and go and sell it in the street for a little bit less. But anyway, our brand is still very much in its infancy, but mainland China is not Hong Kong. Mainland China there's a direct correlation between wealth and wine knowledge and wine consumption. They really, really want to know and understand it. And I've been there to try to, I think it's a golden opportunity for me to honor my new partners, to try to build our brand recognition. And I guarantee you, more people know Painted Rock in Shanghai than they do a lot of the big names, just because I've been there. I've been there for so much in the last 6 months, and it's the demographic that are learning are young. They're people that are, they say people in the wine industry in China, like servers and people, the average person that has anything to do with the wine industry in China spends over 20% of their income on education. So I recognize that as a really, really fertile market and for us as an industry. So I've probably overspoken the question, but we're getting the breadth of our brand out there, which is our goal.
Jason.
Yeah, have you guys ever done butchering class or thought about doing that?
No, we haven't done any classes per se at this time, but we have had a few chefs into stage and you know, watch, you know, what we're doing, breaking down beef or pork. It's come up as a topic of, you know, is there an opportunity to do anything with that? It's not so easy when we're so busy with our day-to-day production, but we have had people in just to at least check it out and see what we're doing.
With respect to chocolate, do you see something new and interesting coming up?
So new and exciting. So obviously not bacon and chocolate.
Yeah.
So 2009. As far as chocolate, I mean, terroir is really interesting with chocolate. You know, like all the, they're really doing a lot of comparisons as far as like wine and chocolate and where chocolate comes from, single plantations, single origin, that kind of chocolate. Yeah. And that's not the chocolate I use. I use organic chocolate and I use usually a blend of chocolate. But there's certainly that. And as far as what's new in chocolate, I mean, certainly nostalgic flavors, old-fashioned candies, and some, like, I don't know, more challenging things. People are always trying to put, you know, the latest and greatest thing in pair with chocolate, and I'm not sure where that will be. But maybe you.
I guess for me the big issue is the politics and the ethics of the actual growing of cocoa. Again, chocolate is a really special thing in that we can only grow cocoa between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, so in the equatorial regions around the world, which are all really sort of unstable political regions. In West Africa, where the Ivory Coast and Ghana, where 56% of the global production occurs, there's a huge issue with child labor, forced labor. So for me, I think that's the bigger issue going forward with chocolate, is how are we going to address that as consumers? You take something that people pay pennies a pound for at the source, and then we convert it into this luxury good in the first world. So that's been our struggle, my partner Jess and I, from the beginning, is how can we kind of rationalize that for ourselves and be comfortable with the fact that we're using a product that so many people are being abused to produce. So that's why we've chosen to work with Cluzel, where they maintain a direct relationship with the growers, trying to foster a better relationship between the end user and the producer. So that's what we're trying to sort of strive for going forward, is creating a more equitable system for everybody.
And Do you think the changes in the chocolate industry that are happening right now are similar to what's going on in the coffee industry, and also from the consumer side, how that's changing people's perspective? Because there's sort of a coffee culture now, and I think chocolate with Coco Cubino and all of these different people who are really focusing on that on a more mass-produced level, is that changing things for you, and do you relate your industry to coffee sometimes in those changes?
Very, very much so. It's grown in the same region, same political issues, same social issues, and it's the same as wine, same as coffee, in that the region where the plants are grown has a huge effect on the end flavor profile. So that the comparisons are definitely there, and we'd like to see a similar culture created around chocolate where people have an awareness of where their chocolate comes from, and creating that connection and that understanding from a social perspective.
Everything is getting like crazy with these ingredients and these herbs and you name it in the chocolate. Do you guys find that it's become a huge battle to keep up with the next big thing? Because in the States and here, there's always these new ingredients. It seems to me like this enormous competition. Do you feel that it's something you really need to stay in business, is to produce like the up and coming pear chocolate ingredient? Because some of the best chocolates in the world are just simple chocolate, right, obviously. Do you feel that pressure? Does it seem that way to small chocolate companies, that you keep needing to come up with the next great thing to stay in business? Or is it just simply a pure pleasure producing something new and great through experimentation?
It's definitely just the pleasure of experimenting and being creative. Innovation is easy. It's easy to say, let's take this crazy thing and put it with something else that doesn't make any sense and see what happens. I don't think it's what people want to eat most of the time. I think there's definitely a curiosity. But at the end of the day, I think we sort of go back to the more simple, basic things, chocolate and coffee, chocolate and nuts, just chocolate. I don't think we have to get crazy to stay in business. I think we have to make good food to stay in business. And that's our focus at the end of the day. We don't want to make some sort of crazy flavor combination just for the sake of making a crazy flavor combination. If we happen to come up with some sort of interesting flavor combination that works really well and that we enjoy eating, then it's something that we'll make and sell. But we're not innovating just for the sake of innovation, to say, look at all these crazy things that we do.
Good.
Yep.
As far as us and innovation, I mean, like, our product line is, we have 8 SKUs right now, as in like 8 products, and we're set to release another dozen pretty soon. But they're all, there's nothing really that crazy about them. We don't use wasabi or ghost peppers or
hot sauce
or anything. Yeah, crazy. And the chocolate, because it really goes back to what, like Adam was saying, what I want to eat, and like I make things that I want to eat, and I hope that other people also will enjoy those things. And if people don't enjoy those things, we stop making those things and we focus on the ones that they do enjoy. And a friend of mine owns a shoe store, and she calls it the red shoe theory. And so like in her store, she always has a crazy expensive beautiful pair of shoes that people come and look at, and they say, like, wow, look at these amazing shoes, but nobody actually buys the red shoes. People buy, you know, like the black flats, or, you know, like the sneakers, you know, like the everyday shoes, but people like to go to a store where they have the red shoes, so they can say that they shop at that store with the red shoe. And so, if following what I'm saying, that, like, it's always nice to have a little bit of innovation, as long as there's a lot of, like, you know, safe, comfortable flats.
I just have a quick question for Wendy. I just want to know what the best chocolate you've eaten is and where we can get it.
Yeah, so obviously it's the vanilla salt caramel with peanut butter crunch from Cocolico by Wendy Morris, that's me. And you can buy it reliably at Edible Canada online, cocolico.ca. As far as other amazing chocolates go, though, I mean, chocolate's really good. right? Like, people like chocolate, and so I'm perhaps not as particular as I should be, because I like chocolate, I eat chocolate every day. Today I decided to buy like dairy milk, I think, has come out with a whole new line of like curried cashew and toasted coconut and like a whole bunch of other like crazy flavors. So I was like, well, those sound interesting. They were pretty good. But I bought them and like we broke them up at the test kitchen and tasted them. But yeah, as far as making chocolate, like I like it. My favorite chocolate, actually my personal favorite chocolate, is like when I get a fresh bag of Javara, that's a melt chocolate from Valrhona, 41% melt chocolate that's kind of like caramelly and malty. When I get a fresh case and I open up that first bag out of that fresh case and I take one of those pistils and like inhale the aroma and like eat it fresh out of the bag, that's my best chocolate experience, especially if it's like before 8 o'clock in the morning.
This question's for Jason. Question about the types of cattle out there. Are you finding a lot of demand between like grass-fed and grain-fed? And do you think that argument is going to keep going, or is there actually a real difference? Are people willing to pay for the national price difference of that? And I guess which is at the end of the day more sustainable from a market perspective?
You know, there's always a massive demand for grass-fed cattle. It's what everybody talks about, but it's what really is not available. Canada is, in general, I mean, let's just talk about BC in terms of cattle. Like, we don't really have the climate to have grass-fed and grass-finished. So that's really the technical difference, that all beef is grass-fed at one point in their life. It's how much that it hits a feedlot to really change the components of the meat. You can have grass-finished product, and there certainly is grass-finished meat around, but it's just not in a large supply. And to really have proper grass-finished cattle, you really only have a three-month window because the grass needs to be growing. And because we have snow and all these other elements, it doesn't bode well to have grass-finished. And a lot of times the farmers that do grass-finished, they don't have the finishing connection with a processor that will take their meat and finish it properly, because such an important aspect of meat, especially beef, is what happens after you pull the dress off it, if that makes sense. It needs to be hung properly and taken care of and so on. And a lot of farms that are the farm gate types of applications that do grass finished beef, they don't have the ability to take care of it after it's been killed, and so it's a lot of times it's frozen within a few days of everything happening, and so it hasn't had time to set up yet. So there's always been I had this beautiful grass finished beef, or I bought this product, it was grass finished, and I didn't buy it again, or that kind of thing, because they just don't have the finish, the ability to do that, and there isn't we don't have the ability to do it year round. So what Pemberton does, and I know there's a few other farms that do it, is the beef is grass-fed for a larger portion, a longer portion of its life. And then a lot of times it gets finished on grain. Basically what that does, it dries it up, it changes the color of the fat, and it takes away some of the strength, the flavor that you get out of grass. Now, arguably, there are people that will say that the Argentinian beef is the best of the best in the world. And, I don't know that for a fact because I've never tasted it, but but those cattle are between 4 and 6 years old. That will never happen here. They have, especially with what happened with mad cow, they talk about under 30 months UTM versus over 30 months and what happens. Nothing happens to the product, but you think about age of an animal and you get flavor. Age is flavor. So it doesn't happen so much here, but we have the ability with Pemberton we're killing animals at 22, 24, 28 months, so there is a bit more depth of flavor that you get that kind of aspect of grass finished, but it is grain finished. So very different from something that happens in a feedlot, where commodity beef would hit that feedlot at 8 months of age and it would be on a plate at 14 months.
so you don't get that really the big depth of flavor.
So anyway, thank you again for all the speakers for coming and speaking to us. I'm sure everybody learned a lot. I did. And Tyler will be handing out the treats on the way out, so enjoy your beta 5 chocolates. I'm very curious to see what's in that box. Thank you again.